I am super enthusiastic about starting to record this section of the course. Teaching about wavelets and time frequency analysis is one of my favorite things to talk about, and I hope you are also really excited for this section. I mean, okay, the entire course is really fun and exciting, and I hope you are excited for everything, but this section is particularly cool. And that's because we are going to go beyond the primary limitation of static spectral analyses that you have already learned about so far and by this time in the course. There are several methods for doing time frequency analysis. In this course, I'm going to introduce you to four, I think it is. Yeah, that's right. So in this course, I'm going to teach you four methods for time frequency analysis, but I will spend the most amount of time, the most amount of energy talking about wavelet convolution, and in particular, complex Morlet wavelet convolution. It's not the only way to do a time frequency analysis, but it has several really great advantages. There are several reasons why Morlet wavelet convolution is a really great way of doing time frequency analysis. There is conceptual clarity, there is computation time, so it's really fast to implement. It doesn't have so many analysis parameters that you need to be worried about, which means it's easier to do the analysis and it's harder to get it wrong accidentally. And so in this video, what I'm going to do is, well, I'll start by giving a brief reminder of the primary limitation of static spectral analyses, which will motivate time frequency analysis. And then mainly in this video, I'm going to introduce you to Morlet wavelets, show you what they look like in the time domain, how to create them, and how what they look like in the frequency domain. So let's begin. These are two plots that you have seen quite a few times already in this course. This shows a time domain signal and its power spectrum, or maybe it's the amplitude spectrum, from the FFT. Now, the primary limitation of a static spectral analysis is that it is visually easily interpretable only for stationary signals, so signals that do not change their characteristics over time. Now, this signal is highly non-stationary. You can see that the spectral characteristics of this signal are changing a lot over time, and other characteristics as well. So now we see that there is this bump here in gamma, and when you see both of these plots together, then, you know, it's obvious in this particular case, because the SNR is so high, this is such a clean signal, it's obvious from looking at these two plots together that this gamma is mainly coming from this time window here. However, if you don't see the time domain signal, you just see the frequency domain signal, then you really have no idea what, if any, are the temporal characteristics of this feature or anything else going on here. So that is the primary motivation of time frequency analyses. We want to combine the temporal precision of time domain investigations that allows us to quantify and visualize the temporal dynamics of these features, but we also want to be able to extract spectrally specific, so frequency specific information over time. And so, as I mentioned, one of the primary methods for doing time frequency analysis, and the one that I will focus most on, is called wavelet convolution. So I'm going to just spend some time talking a little bit about wavelets. Wavelets, by the way, like many other mathematical objects, can be implemented in computers and visualized and turn out to be quite beautiful. They are quite just visually aesthetically pleasing in addition to their important mathematical properties. So what you're looking at here is a collection of wavelets that are all plotted on top of each other. So what you can already notice about wavelets is that they taper to zero, they get very close to zero at the beginning and at the end. So this will be time equals zero. This would be like the middle of time. So here we have negative time, or negative x, doesn't necessarily have to be a time axis. So as you go towards negative infinity and positive infinity, these things taper to zero. Here you see one of these wavelets, and you can see that it sort of, it wiggles up and down. You can already see that there is a sine wave component, and it's kind of getting tapered here towards the beginning and towards the end. Now, there are many different kinds of wavelets. I'm not going to talk about all of the possible wavelets. For something to be a wavelet, it needs to have two key properties. It needs to taper down to zero. It needs to get arbitrarily close to zero in the beginning and at the end. And it needs to integrate to zero, which means that all the positive bits and all the negative bits have to cancel each other out. So the sum total is zero over time. So what is a wavelet? Let's think about this term, wavelet, to try and understand what wavelets mean and where they come from. So where do wavelets come from? Many languages have a part of speech called a diminutive. A diminutive is typically a little sound, a short sound that you can add to the end of a noun to indicate that it's a smaller version of that noun. For example, in Dutch, you have the word table, which is tafel, and then you can add a tje at the end. So you can say tafel, tafel tje, and a tafel tje is like a small, cute little table. So you can think about whether your language, your native language or other languages you might know, have a diminutive, something that makes it small and cute. So in English, it turns out that we have the let is the diminutive. So for example, here we have a river. I think this is the Amazon River. And here is a tiny, tiny little stream. It's smaller than a stream. This is actually called a rivulet. So it's like a riverlet. So a small, cute version of a river. Here we have an eye. This is called an eyelet. That's actually the thing in your shoes that you stick the shoelace through. Here we have a book and a booklet. Everyone knows that one. And now, okay, I have to warn you. I really thought for a while about whether I should include this particular slide in this presentation, because as bad as my jokes are, they tend to go better in person than online. But anyway, here is just another example of adding a let to something. So Scarface and Scarlett Johansson. I promise there are very, very few really horrible jokes in the rest of this course. Anyway, so where do wavelets come from? Well, we take a wave, like a sine wave, and we make it smaller and cuter, and then we add the let, the diminutive, to the end. So here is a sine wave. This is a Gaussian, and what we are going to do is pointwise multiply the sine wave by the Gaussian. And you can see what's going to happen. That's going to taper the sine wave here. It's going to taper the sine wave here, and the sine wave will be left with complete energy here in the center of the Gaussian. So here you see a couple of formulas. This is the formula for, in fact, a complex valued sine wave. This is just the real part of the sine wave. Now, you can also make real valued wavelets. This one here is a real valued wavelet because I'm not showing the imaginary part to it. But for time frequency analysis, as you might guess from the previous section learning about the Fourier transform, we actually do need to use complex valued wavelets. So we take a complex valued sine wave. So here you see the math, here you see the MATLAB code, and then we take a Gaussian, here you see the formula, and here you see the corresponding code, and then we just combine them together. So we element-wise multiply. We're not summing here, we're not taking the dot product between the sine wave and the Gaussian, we are just doing element-wise multiplication. Now to be clear, there are many, many, many types of wavelets. There are different families of wavelets and members of those families. There's a pretty big variety of wavelets out there. And you can actually invent your own wavelets. You know, there are new wavelets to be discovered. So this particular way of creating a wavelet where you take a sine wave and multiply it by a Gaussian, this is called a Morlet wavelet. And then when it's complex valued sine wave, it's a complex Morlet wavelet. So for the rest of this course, I'm simply going to be using the term wavelet instead of explicitly all the time saying Morlet wavelet, but it's important for you to realize that not all wavelets are Morlet wavelets. There are more wavelets than just what you see on this screen here. Morlet wavelets happen to have really great properties that make them very amenable to a time frequency analysis. Different kinds of wavelets that are created in different ways are useful for different kinds of purposes. So just keep in mind that in the context of this course, I'm going to be sometimes using Morlet wavelets, and sometimes I will just call them wavelets, but be aware that when you go to parties and you talk to other time frequency data analysts, that if you talk about wavelets and they talk about wavelets, you might not be talking about the exact same thing. All right, so anyway, let's talk about why wavelets provide temporal specificity. So here we have some time domain signal, and now let's think about the Fourier transform. So each step of the Fourier transform involves computing the dot product between this signal and this sine wave, which now I'm going to start using the term kernel. This term kernel comes from a procedure called convolution, and I will introduce this terminology in a few videos, but the term doesn't matter. So the Fourier transform involves computing the dot product between this sine wave, it's a pure sine wave, and this signal. So let's take a moment and think about what would be like the weighting function of this sine wave. So how does this, what is the part of this signal that is weighted by this kernel, this sine wave? Well, the answer is the entire signal. This is a amplitude 1 sine wave. It's a stationary sine wave. So the amplitude is constant over time. So that means that the weighting function of this sine wave onto this signal is constant. So the entire signal gets weighted equally. And that is why we have no temporal specificity from the Fourier transform. Whatever's happening here gets averaged together with whatever's happening here. Okay, so now let's think about the corresponding temporal weighting function for this kernel. This is a Morlet wavelet, so you can see it's a sine wave, and it gets tapered down from the Gaussian. Now, these are all zeros here, you know, very, very, very close to zero here and here. So what would the weighting function look like on this time series signal when we compute the dot product with this kernel and not with this kernel? You guessed it, it would look something like this. So when we compute the dot product between this kernel, this wavelet, and this data signal time series, then all of this stuff, it doesn't matter what's happening in the signal out here, it's getting multiplied by zero. It doesn't matter what's happening in the signal here, this is getting multiplied by zero. All we have from the signal is what's happening here, which is basically like, you know, under the envelope of the Gaussian. So we get a weighting function that looks like this. So now you can imagine if we would just repeat the Fourier transform, but instead of using pure sine waves, we use these wavelets like this, and then we repeat exactly the Fourier transform, you can see that that is going to give us spectrally specific information about this signal that is temporally localized only to this region here. Now, that would be great if all we cared about was this region. Of course, that's not sufficient. We care about what's happening here and here and here and here and here and everywhere else. So you can probably already see where this is going. What we are going to do is something that's a little bit like the Fourier transform. It's definitely going to involve dot products, but instead of only doing it once, where this kernel is exactly in the center, or this sort of region of non-zero energy in the wavelet is aligned to exactly the center of this signal. Instead, we are going to be taking this kernel and dragging it along, so sliding it along this signal and computing the dot product over and over and over again so that this window here is going to slide along the time series. Now, that is a totally intuitive operation. That is the whole idea of convolution. I'm going to talk more about convolution in the next several videos, but I want you to see already that, you know, this is a pretty straightforward, sensible operation that we are working towards to implement time frequency analysis. If we stuck you in a room, just knowing what you know about the Fourier transform and now learning a little bit about wavelets, you would also come up with convolution, or a procedure that is almost exactly like convolution. All right, so finally in this video, I want to talk a little bit about what Morlet wavelets look like in the time domain and in the frequency domain. So here you see a Morlet wavelet in the time domain. In fact, this is just the real part of the Morlet wavelet. We are going to be working with complex Morlet wavelets, as you will see in a few videos from now. So what you're looking at here is the real part. The imaginary part looks really similar, but it's defined by a sine component. This is the cosine component. You can see it's an even function. So the sine component looks a little wobbly, but it's generally a similar looking thing. So Now I want to know what the amplitude spectrum or the power spectrum of this wavelet is going to look like. So what does this thing look like in the frequency domain? Now before I show this plot, I want you to already guess what the general shape of this thing is going to be in the frequency domain. So to think about this, let's think about the fact that this is created from a pure sine wave. So if this were a pure sine wave, then the amplitude spectrum would be all zeros everywhere and just one spike, just an impulse at exactly this frequency. Maybe this is 5 hertz. So there would be a spike at 5 hertz and zero energy, zero amplitude everywhere else in the spectrum. But this is not a pure sine wave. It is a sine wave that has been tapered by a Gaussian. And what that Gaussian does is introduce some non-stationarities. There are amplitude non-stationarities in this signal. So the amplitude is basically zero here and here and getting larger here. So what is the effect of non-stationarities in the time domain on the spectral representation, so in the frequency domain? You guessed it, it's going to get widened out. It's going to be, instead of a perfect spike, it's going to be a little bit wider. Somehow the shape is going to be a little bit wider because the Fourier transform will require energy at other frequencies other than the sine wave frequency in order to represent these amplitude non-stationarities. Okay, so I hope you've already guessed that the representation in the frequency domain is going to be something like this. We get a peak at the frequency used to create the sine wave here. So my memory served me well. This was a 5 hertz wavelet. So we have a 5 hertz sine wave, and then we get a peak at 5 hertz. And this looks a bit like a Gaussian. In fact, this is really a Gaussian. That is one of the cool features of Morlet wavelets. In the time domain, you use a Gaussian to create the wavelet, and in the frequency domain, the amplitude spectrum is a Gaussian. In fact, so much so that you can also create a Morlet wavelet, not in the time domain, as I showed a few moments ago. You can create a Morlet wavelet in the frequency domain by just creating a Gaussian in the frequency domain and taking the inverse Fourier transform of that frequency domain Gaussian. That's also going to give you a Morlet wavelet. Okay, so now that you have some basic introduction to the Morlet wavelet in theory, it is time to see what these things look like in MATLAB, and from there we will start learning about convolution.